Read together Psalms 146, verses 1 and 2. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, my soul. I will praise the Lord while I live. I will sing praises to my God while I have my being.
Lord of all the earth.
Good morning, church. Isn't it good to be here in this place as we gather in the name of our Lord to worship Him? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, thank you. Thank you for this morning. Thank you for meeting us here at this place as we gather as your children, as your servants, to worship and glorify you. Father, I ask that the words that we share with each other, the words that we hear from your word, the words that we sing this morning together glorify you. May all that we do lift your name up on high. Lord, we thank you in your son's holy and precious name. Amen. Again, welcome. Glad to have every one of you here today, both those here in person and those who are joining us online. A couple of quick announcements that we have. Our men's group meets every Tuesday at 9:30 a.m. for prayer and Bible discussion here at the church. And on Wednesdays, we have our midweek Bible study at 7 p.m. We are going through the book of Hebrews. We'd love to have you join us for these. Before church on every week at 10 to 10:30, we join together for coffee and goodies and fellowship. We would love to have you join us for that each week. On August 19th, it's a Monday, we're having our cabinet meeting. Just a reminder to those part of the cabinet to be there. And also, it's a reminder that our cabinet meeting is open to all regular attenders and members. Our electric project, the project is completed, but we still have to pay for it. So far, we have a 22% has come in, $2,126 of the $1,100 and change will be coming in over the next several months. Continue for those who are involved and those who'd like to help out, continue in that over the next few months. I'm hoping to give an update at the first of every month. This Friday is our family game night here at the church. We're gathered together for a time to spend together in fellowship, and we're using games as part of the excuse. I would love to have you join us, bring some snacks, but most of all, bring yourself as we strive to have that time. This evening at 6:30 p.m., we're continuing our series on cultures in conflict, the second part of the Paul Proclaims Jesus as Lord. Ray Vanderland is going to be in Corinth as he shares about Paul's journeys and also all of his teachings from location, as well as our time as we sing praise to the Lord this evening at 6:30 p.m. Let's continue in worshiping our Lord.
Describe it. Where shall its praise begin? Good morning, church. God is blessing us. I believe John the Baptist, or as Chuck Swindoll calls him, John the Baptizer, always knew with clarity, both in his mind and in his heart, the reasons why and what his purpose was, even from his mother's womb, to be here and or to occupy a time in this earth. In Luke 1:39-45, we have the account where Mary pays a visit to Elizabeth. She gets ready in a hurry and out of town. She went into the country hills of Judea, where she enters Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. In a loud voice, she exclaimed, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear." But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as the sound of your greetings reached my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. Blessed she who has believed that what the Lord has said to her will be accomplished. These leaps and bounds are the testimony of God to both Elizabeth and Mary about his promises. Little John, 6 months in the womb, and Mary, a brand new mother-to-be, we see here excitement on both of them. We see the indwelling receiving of the Holy Spirit in Mary, and also the son in her womb knew and was part of our blessing. We see that at the moment of leaping, joy was already present. We see acknowledgement from Elizabeth about Mary, but more about little Jesus, that she calls him Lord, and she counts all of that as being favored or blessed. We see faithfulness in their belief for what the Lord has promised to both of them. He would accomplish it in both of them. When John was asked whom he was, he told them the truth. In John 1:19-23, first he said whom he was not, and then whom he was. Read John 1:19-23 at home. In verse 20, we have this answer from John to the people: "I am not the Christ," because they asked him if he was the Christ. He says, "I'm not the Christ." In verse 21, he says, "I am not Elijah." And in verse 21b, he says, "I am not the prophet." What prophet? It could be Isaiah or any other. The truth in all its beauty, when asked, "Truly, who are you?" he responded in the words of Isaiah the prophet in verse 23, "I am the voice of one calling in the wilderness. Make straight the way of the Lord." He was only the mouthpiece of God with a mic. I can see, I can feel serenity in the voice of John. Now, when he gets questioned by other groups like the Pharisees, He answered the same way. He answered the truth, verse 24 and 25. We know that the Pharisees are there to only cause trouble for John. They question the integrity of his words and the actions of the baptism he was giving to people. In verse 24, we read, now some Pharisees who had been sent questioned him, why then you baptize if you are not the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet? John has a little bit more to say to them about baptism. Verse 26 through 27a, I baptize with water, John replied, but among you stands one you do not know, and he is the one who comes after me, and he will baptize you with the Spirit. John's baptism is only of repentance and with water, or in water. He says that the one he is introducing has one that is a much better. He will baptize for the remission of our sins, Jesus, and for the acknowledgement that we as believers say and have in whom he is and what he's about to do. He has come to die for our sins. In verse 29b, the straps of the sandals, he says, I am not worthy to untie. Today, that is what John said. And I hope you understand me. It's a little bit different talking, but today he says, is what John said. This is what John said. And tomorrow, he will have even better things to say. In verse 29, the next day, John saw Jesus coming towards him and said, look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. What a statement. Do you know what this means? There is a company that makes hats and t-shirts and this and that. And it has this H-E a sign that I don't know what it's called, but it's like this. And a minor I. Do you know what that is? What that means? It means, John stated this, and I'll tell you in a minute. John stated this in John 3:30. It says, he must become greater, and I must become less. That symbol means he is greater than I. What a statement again from John, and what can we learn? To always put Jesus in the place and in the position that he deserves. He is always greater than all of us together. John is saying that Jesus has surpassed him because Jesus was even before him. So Jesus is from everlasting to everlasting. And the one that deserves all glory, honor, and praises. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for sending your son. It was horrible the way we treat him. But he loved us. And he didn't take into account our insult and our sin. He just asked and said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing. And yet that those people there in that day, the world in those days represented the world entirely, from many nations, many kingdoms, many people. And we all were part of that aggression against the Son of God, because we are sinners. And Jesus came to save and forgive our sins. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Will you repeat with me the good confession? I believe with all my heart that Jesus is the Son, the Christ, the Son of the living God. And now it's time for our tithes and offerings and faith promises that we have. God is supplying and providing so that we can do so also with the moving of the church, the walking of the church. So if you have your special offering, just after the prayer, deposit. Oh Lord, thank you for every blessing and every provision that you made. Thank you for the provision for some, the work, and for some of us, other ways. But Lord, help us to be faithful to you in our giving, so that you can continue to bless us, so that your kingdom will be much larger. Just help us. Help us to help others who need, who are in need. And thank you for those who have helped us. And thank you for providing that very thing that we need to give you thanks and gratitude. All the honor and praise for what you do in us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Psalm 66:19 says, "But truly God has listened. He has attended to the voice of my prayers." God listens to our prayers. He rejoices in our praises. Let me share a couple of our praises this morning that we have. Kathy Gilman, that's my mom, is home from the hospital. She's been up at Orchard Hospital for several weeks now, and she's finally home. Strength is really doing well. Her spirit is up, and so we just thank you for those who've been praying for my mom. Mickey and her father are back from their trip down to Los Angeles last weekend, and we are glad that she's with us this morning. And also a praise for the blessings that we've received because of the visitors that have been joining us over the last several weeks and actually months. And we rejoice in the Lord that we have the opportunity to fellowship with our visitors. Some prayers that we have. Jerry Johnson, and along with Marissa and her husband, are up traveling in Washington State for several weeks. So we want to keep them in our prayers. Sally Eaton asks for wisdom in sharing with her friends and neighbors. The Lord's been sending several in her direction recently. Sue Andrews asks that we would pray for her sister Rose, who's been having breathing problems. And also Sue has asked for prayers for herself. She's been having quite a few seizures lately, and so we want to keep her in our prayers. And also, our kids program is starting up in just about a little bit less than a month, the first Tuesday of September, which isn't that far away. So I'll actually keep Bonnie in your prayers as she gets everything lined up for when the kids come. Also for all those that will be working with her during this time. And also take some time to pray for our families and friends who are dealing with struggles. Struggles such as financial or emotional struggles, health and physical struggles, and or spiritual struggles. And we also want to pray for the opportunities that we have as a church and as individuals, believers in Christ, that we will be used by God to meet the needs of the people that He places in our way. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we thank You. We thank You that we can be here today. We thank You for being able to gather and to worship You. But Father, we've been able to look around in our lives today, and we see You not just working with us here in this place, but in our lives outside of here. Thank You for being with my mom while she was in the hospital. I just thank You for bringing her strength. I just, she continues to get more strength as she is home with the extra help that she has. Thank You for being with Mickey and her father as they traveled to Los Angeles and back. We're grateful to have her with us here this morning. And Father, we are grateful for the blessings that You've blessed us with the visitors that we've had over the last several weeks. Father, help us as a church family to reach out and minister to the needs that they may have as they join us in worshiping You. Father, I also ask You to be with Jerry and Marissa and her husband as they travel. Keep them safe while they're on the roads. And Father, just bring them back safe as they finish visiting and doing that which they're doing up in Washington State. Father, I just thank You that for the heart that You gave Sally. For those who have broken lives and struggles that seem to find their way into her life, Father, give her the wisdom that she needs as she ministers to them, as she shares Your love with them. May they see You in her. And Father, we lift up to You, Sue Andrews. Father, You know the struggle she's been going through, all the different things that are on her plate. But Father, right now I ask that You be with her health, Father, with the seizures that she's been having. Father, just pray that the doctors that are dealing with her and helping her, you know, get everything set up right so that her health can be better. Father, be with her sister Rose with the breathing problems that she's been having. Father, just pray that You give her what she needs so she can see You working in her life. And Father, we are so grateful for the for Bonnie that You've brought into our church family, working with these kids for these many years. Father, another group are coming up. A new program is going to be starting in a few weeks. And Father, these weeks here are going to be really busy for her as she tries to get everything put together. Father, give her the wisdom and the patience and the strength as she takes the time. And also, Father, be with her as she takes care of Doug with the physical problems that he has. Father, we also want to lift up friends and family that we have. And Father, we pause right now for each of us to lift up the names of a friend or family we know who's going through struggles. Father, we thank you that those whom are on our hearts, you have as much love for and concern. And Father, we lay these lives before you, knowing that you are the one who can meet the needs, provide the healing and the strength and the wisdom. And Father, as a church family and as your children, we thank you for the opportunities that are up ahead of us, Father, and give us the wisdom and the strength to be able to make the right choices and say the right words and do the right actions so that your love can be conveyed in the lives of others. And Father, be with me as I share from your word. Father, I ask that the words that I say, the words that we hear, are the words you want us to hear and the words you want me to say, so that our lives can be touched by you and we'll have the tools we need to get over the big mistakes that we may make in our lives. Father, we thank you in your son's holy and precious name. Amen. This morning, as we continue in our sermon series, Avoiding Life's Biggest Mistakes, we are going to be looking at an Old Testament story and then some words from the book of Romans, specifically Romans chapter 12, verses 17 to 21. Let me read those to you. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Carefully consider what is right in the eyes of everybody. If it is possible on your part, live at peace with everyone. Do not avenge yourselves, beloved, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him a drink. For in so doing, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Saturday morning cartoons. The other day I was watching, I don't remember what I was watching, but a commercial came on for the Looney Tunes cartoons. That's what I think of when I think of Saturday morning cartoons. Growing up, those cartoons are there and they're coming back. Cartoons are different these days, aren't they? Looney Tunes, Bugs Bunny, Daffy Duck, Elmer Fudd. And then there's Tweety Bird, Sylvester and Granny. And then Pepe Le Pew, Marty Martian, and the Tasmanian Devil. And we can't forget Foghorn Leghorn, Speedy Gonzales, and Porky Pig with his that's all, folks. Brings a smile to my face when I think of the Looney Tunes. But as I got to thinking about our topic today, there was another set of cartoon characters. Wile E. Coyote and the Roadrunner. Remember them? Well, one person described them as an eternal battle of need versus speed, aggravation versus acceleration. The luckless Wile E comes up with increasingly elaborate and seemingly foolproof schemes to snag the Roadrunner, who, oblivious to the danger, always eludes the pathetic coyote's plans. You might remember how Wile E always ordered the things that he needed for his schemes from the Acme Company. Such things as anvils and axle grease, bed springs and bird seed and bombs. Girl Roadrunner costume, giant mousetrap, glue, invisible paint, iron pellets, jet-propelled pogo sticks, nitroglycerin, roller skates, roller skis, and of course, a lot of TNT. And so everything Wile E. Coyote tried to do to get the Roadrunner ended up backfiring and harming himself. Bombs set for the Roadrunner didn't go off until Wile E. got there. Anvils that were supposed to fall on the Roadrunner always seemed to fall on him. So many times he learned about gravity the hard way. That's how it is when trying to bring about the demise of someone else. Trying to get revenge usually ends up hurting you more than the person you're trying to hurt. In the book of Proverbs, there's one proverb that really points this out. If a man digs a pit, he will fall into it. If a man rolls a stone, it will roll back on him. The Message paraphrase gives it a little bit more simple. It is rendered this way. Malice backfires, spite boomerangs. As we continue in our series, Avoiding Life's Biggest Mistakes, this morning we're going to talk about avoiding the mistake of revenge. Our good, bad example comes out of the Old Testament book of Esther. Last week, we looked at the character of Samson. Today, we're going to look at another character from the book of Esther. And no, it's not Esther. It's the evil person, the villain in the story, Haman. It's a powerful story about the danger of seeking revenge. The story isn't just a few verses or a paragraph or a chapter. It's basically the entire book. But we're going to mainly be looking at chapters 2 through 7. We will be reading what I think are some of the key verses, and I will fill in the details before. So let's start off by looking at the story. The story begins with King Xerxes needing to find a new queen. He then has his search people scour the kingdom looking for the most beautiful virgins and invites them to come for a beauty pageant. Now, this might call the original reality program, but the prize is much bigger than the reality programs of today, The Bachelor, The Voice, America's Got Talent. No. They only get about $1 million or less. Now this contest, the winner becomes queen of an empire. So we're introduced to this one girl, Esther. We're introduced to her in verse 7 of Esther 2. And Mordecai had brought up Hadassias, I cannot pronounce her name, but luckily she's also, that is Esther, much easier to read by the way, the daughter of his uncle, because she did not have a father or mother. The young woman was lovely in form and appearance. Esther was Jewish. Her parents had died when she was being raised by her cousin Mordecai, who was a Jew from the tribe of Benjamin. When the attendants came around and picked Esther because she was such lovely in form and appearance, heading off to this beauty pageant, Mordecai counseled her not to reveal her nationality and family background. And all the girls were chosen for this competition. They received 12 months of beauty treatments. When the competition took place, Esther won the favor of everyone who saw her. The king was attracted to Esther more than any other women, and she won his favor and more than all the rest. So King Xerxes set a royal crown on her head. She won. She became Queen Esther. Now, not long after that, Mordecai, Queen Esther's cousin, discovered a plot that two of the king's officers had put together to assassinate King Xerxes. Now, Mordecai immediately told Esther about it, and Esther immediately told her husband, the king, making sure that Mordecai was given credit for uncovering the plot on the king's life. An investigation took place. Mordecai's report was found to be true, and those two officials were hanged on the gallows. And all of this was recorded in the official records of the kingdom in the presence of the king. Now, later, after these events occurred, King Xerxes decided to honor a man by the name of Haman. Yes, he's the villain in the story. He's the son of Hamadatha. I cannot pronounce that name either, but he's also given, described as the Agite. The king elevated him, giving him a seat of honor higher than all the other nobles. And the royal officials at the king's gate would bow down and pray honor to Haman every time he came by. That is, all except for Mordecai. Mordecai would not kneel down or pay him honor. When Haman saw that Mordecai would not kneel down, he got really, really mad. And when he learned who Mordecai's people were, he scorned the idea of only taking care of or killing Mordecai. Instead, he looked for a way to get rid of all of Mordecai's people, to kill all the Jews. There's some debate, though, about the ancestry of Haman. He's given the title Agite, and many people feel that that's a clue as to his background. And the Agite could refer to some relative, or most likely it referred to Agag, the king of the Amalekites. The Amalekites had attacked Israel when they left Egypt. It's recorded in Exodus chapter 17. And then in verse 16, we read, "The Lord will give war with Amalek from generation to generation." And then before entering the promised land, the Lord told Israel, "Remember what the Amalekites did to you along your way from Egypt. You are to blot out the memory of Amalek from under heaven. Do not forget." In 1 Samuel 15, we read about King Saul. And King Saul is told by God to attack Amalek that resulted in the death of King Agag. You can read about the story. It's quite a bit complex. It's because that story is when Saul got himself in trouble. But the reality is, most, but not all, of the population were killed. And then that we now come back to our story. 500 years later, after the Jews had been taken into exile, the Benjaminite Mordecai continues the war with the Amalekites by refusing to bow down to Haman. Only the long-standing enmity between Jews and the Amalekites accounts for both Mordecai's refusal and Haman's intent to destroying all the Jews. Haman came up with a plan. He thought it was a pretty good plan. He told this plan to King Xerxes. He said that there's a certain group of people dispersed and scattered among the people of your kingdom, he said. And Abel told them that they have customs that are different from the rest of the people, and they do not obey your laws. He suggested that it's not in the king's best interest to tolerate such people. And then he suggested that the king issue a decree to destroy these people as a group. Haman said that he would even put up 10,000 talents of silver into the royal treasury for the men to carry out such a business. Basically told the king, "Hey, I will foot the bill for this." Now, 10,000 talents, it's a lot of money. Records show that the annual income of the whole Persian Empire at this time was about 15,000 talents of silver. The king agreed with Haman, saying, "Keep the money and do with the people as you please." So the royal secretaries were summoned, and they wrote out Haman's order, and they would be delivered to all parts of the kingdom. The orders were issued on the 13th day of the first month, and were to be carried out on the 13th day of the 12th month. The order was to kill and annihilate all the Jews, young and old, women and children, on a single day, and then to plunder all that they owned. When Mordecai heard of the decree, he tore his clothes, he put on sackcloth and ashes. He went into the city wailing loudly and bitterly. There was a lot of mourning among the Jews. There was fasting, weeping, and wailing, and many of the Jews were laying in the streets in sackcloth and ashes. Mordecai then sends word to Esther about the decree and urged her to go to the king on their behalf. But Esther reminded him of the danger of approaching the king uninvited. You see, any man or woman who approached the king in the inner court without being summoned, the king had only one law, that he or she would be put to death unless the king held out his scepter to them. And then Esther told Mordecai that it had been 30 days since she was last called to go to the king. Mordecai's response to Esther was, "Do not imagine that because you are in the king's palace, you alone will escape the fate of all the Jews. For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place. But you and your father's house will perish. And who knows if perhaps you have come to the kingdom for such a time as this." So Esther requested that Mordecai have all the Jews fast and pray for 3 days and nights. And then she said, "After that, I will go to the king, even though it is against the law. And if I perish, I perish." So after a time of fasting and praying, Esther put on her royal robes and stood in the inner court of the palace in front of the king's hall. The king was sitting at his throne. When he saw Queen Esther standing in the court, he was pleased to see her, so he held out his gold scepter, and Esther approached and touched the tip of the scepter. And the king then asked her, "What is it, Queen Esther? What is your request? Even up to half the kingdom, it will be given to you." "If it pleases the king," Esther replied, "may the king and Haman come today to the banquet I have prepared for the king." "Hurry," commanded the king, "and bring Haman, so we can do as Esther has requested." So the king and Haman, went to the banquet that Esther had prepared. Now, while they were sitting there drinking wine, the king again asked, "What is your petition? It will be given to you. What is your request? Even up to half the kingdom, it will be fulfilled." Esther didn't answer the question. Instead, she said, "This is my petition and my request. If I have found favor in the sight of the king, and if it pleases the king to grant my petition and fulfill my request, may the king and Haman come tomorrow to the banquet I will prepare for them. Then I will answer the king's question." One can only guess why Esther delayed her answer until the king answered the third time. But we do know is that these delays allowed for things to happen in Haman's life and to settle some decisions that he made. Haman left the presence of Esther and the king, and he was really happy. He was in high spirits. But then on the way heading home, he passed by the gates of the palace, and he saw Mordecai, and he was filled with rage when Mordecai neither rose nor showed fear in Haman's presence. Haman restrained himself and he went home. He called together his friends and family and boasted them about his vast wealth, his many sons, and all the ways the king has elevated him above all the other nobles and officials. And then he added, what is more, Queen Esther invited no one but me to join the king at the banquet she prepared. And I am invited back tomorrow along with the king. Yet none of this satisfies me as long as I see Mordecai the Jew sitting at the king's gate. Haman's wife and friends encouraged him to build a scaffold, a place where the place where he could hang Mordecai, and then go and ask the king in the morning to have Mordecai hanged on it. So he had a 75-foot high scaffolding built right outside of his place that night. Meanwhile, that same night, the king couldn't sleep. So he ordered the book of the Chronicles, the record of his reign, to be brought in and read to him. I guess he thought some boring history would lull him back to sleep. As the record was being read to him, the reader read about the assassination plot that Mordecai had exposed. The king stopped the reader and asked if any honor or recognition had been given to Mordecai for such service. The attendant told him that nothing had been done. Now this is where the story gets interesting. The king asked us if there was anybody in the court. Were there any officers who just happened to be hanging around in the middle of the night? Well, guess who just happened to show up? That's right, Haman. He decided to come early and talk with the king about having Mordecai hung on his newly constructed gallows. And so they brought Haman in to the king. And the king asked Haman, what should be done for the man whom the king is delighted to honor? Now, Haman couldn't think of anyone that the king would want to honor except for Haman. So he told the king, for the man whom the king is delighted to honor, have them bring a royal robe that the king himself has worn, and a horse on which the king himself has ridden, one with a royal crest placed on its head. Let the robe and the horse be entrusted to one of the king's most noble princes. Let them array the man the king wants to honor and parade him on the horse through the city square, proclaiming before him, this is what is done for the man whom the king is delighted to honor. And the king, he really liked that idea. So can you imagine the shock that must have come over Haman when the king commanded, hurry and do just as you proposed. Take the robe and the horse to Mordecai the Jew, who is sitting at the king's gate. Do not neglect anything that you have suggested. I think that's probably the last thing Mordecai wanted to do. But Haman did as he was commanded. It must have been just excruciating for him every step of the way, proclaiming over and over again about the honor of Mordecai. When he was done, Haman rushed home with his head covered in grief, and he told his wife and friends everything that had happened. And this is their reply. Since Mordecai, before whom your downfall has begun, is Jewish, you will not prevail against him, for surely you will fall before him. This is not quite the same thing they were telling him just one day earlier, was it? But before Haman could adjust to what had just taken place, there was a knock at the door. And Haman was escorted back to the palace for Esther's banquet. As the king and Haman were dining with Queen Esther, the king then asked about her petition. And this time, she gave an answer. If I have found favor in your sight, O king, and if it pleases the king, grant me my life and my petition, and the lives of my people as my request. For my people and I have been sold out to destruction, death, and annihilation. If we had merely been sold as men servants and maid servants, I would have remained silent, because so no such distress would justify burdening the king. The king was furious. He demanded to know who would dare to do such a thing. You can probably picture Haman now trying to hide underneath the table to look invisible. And Esther pointed at Haman and said, "The adversary, the enemy, is this wicked man, Haman." The king got so angry. He was so mad. He was so filled with rage that he went up and went out of the garden to cool off. Haman, meanwhile, realized that he was in a desperate situation. So he decided to beg the king for his life. And as Haman tried to throw himself down before the queen in humility, the king returned. And it appeared to him that Haman was assaulting his wife. The king exclaimed, "Would he actually assault the queen while I am in the palace?" While the king paused to decide what to do with Haman, one of his attendants told him that the 75-foot-high gallows that Haman built to hang Mordecai on, you know, the guy that happened to save your life from assassination. So the king said, "Hang Haman on it." So they hanged Haman on the gallows he prepared for Mordecai. That's the story. All of this with Haman reminds us of that proverb that I read earlier. If a man digs a pit, he will fall into it. If a man rolls a stone, it will roll back on him. That's quite a story. So let's talk about the application to this story. Obviously, the story is a powerful story about the faith of Esther and Mordecai. We only read from chapters 2 through 7, but there's several more chapters to this story. But what we do see is God was truly watching over his people. It's not a coincidence that the king could not sleep and just happened to stumble over Mordecai's good deed that he had never been rewarded for. It was not a coincidence that Haman just happened to enter early to see the king and assume that he was the one the king wanted to honor. But I think it's ironic that he was hung on the very same gallows that he built for his enemy. So, what's the application? The personal application that I want us to benefit from today is simply, we must avoid the mistake of seeking revenge. Revenge is a choice. All of us have been wronged by others at some point in our lives, and if you haven't, you will. What are we supposed to do, though, when someone wrongs us and brings all sorts of misery on us and to those that we love? What do we do if our spouse leaves us for someone else? What if we discover that a relative has molested one of our children? What do we do if someone has stolen our identity and ruined us financially? What do we do if our loved one dies because of a drunk driver? What do we do if we are fired because someone lies to our boss about us? Every single one of those, what do we do? In the last couple of years, I know a Christian who I know different Christians where one of these things has happened. Every one of these is represented in people I know. If any of these things or other things like them happen to any of us, our typical reaction is to get even, to get revenge. That may be our typical response. But revenge is not the spiritual nor the helpful response that we need to take. Philip Yancey wrote, "Vengeance is a passion to get even. It is a hot desire to give back as much pain as someone gives you. The problem with revenge is that it never gets what it wants. It never evens the score. Fairness never comes. The chain reaction set off by every act of vengeance always takes its unhindered course. It ties both the injured and the injurer to an escalator of pain. Both are stuck on the escalator as long as parity is demanded. And the escalator never stops, never lets anyone off." Now, don't misunderstand me. I'm not trying to say that people who harm us should not be allowed to just walk away without addressing the injury. Forgiveness does not mean that there will be no consequences. God forgives us our sin, but that does not mean that we don't have to go to jail or pay a fine or face some other consequences because of what we chose to do. Scripture, our scripture reading for Romans 12 gives us some instructions on what we need to do about this matter of revenge. So let's begin, first of all, looking at the first part of verse 17. Paul says, "Do not repay anyone evil for evil." So here we learn that paying back evil for evil does not further God's kingdom. Using evil to pay back evil is just playing into Satan's schemes. You've heard it before, two wrongs don't make a right. Well, the reality is, two wrongs just make a bigger mess. We should never use Satan's schemes to try to right a wrong. It does not work. Continuing, rest of verse 17. "Carefully consider what is right in the eyes of everybody. It is if it is possible on your part, live at peace with everyone." We should make a serious effort to be at peace with others. I like that Paul puts, "if possible on your part, live at peace with everyone." God understands that there are two sides in every disagreement. I have no control over the other person, but I do have control over myself. It was Jesus who said in the Sermon on the Mount, "Blessed are the peacemakers." If we can do it, if we can bring about peace, we need to do so, not take revenge. Verses 19 and 20. "Do not avenge yourselves, beloved, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, 'Vengeance is mine, I will repay,' says the Lord." Here we learn that the desire for revenge is not wrong, but taking our own revenge is. Remember, we are God's children. We are His representatives. We are not the vengeful hands of God. We are His hands of love and peace. We are the examples that He needs us to be to show those around us what His love is like. He could take care of His wrath Himself. Which brings us finally to the rest of verse 20 and verse 21. "On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him a drink. For in doing so, you'll heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good." Here we learn that the desire for revenge, God's way to overcome evil is not with evil, but with good. I like how Paul gives us a couple of examples. If your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him a drink. If you see someone in need, whether he's your enemy or not, help meet that need. Show the compassion that God has put in your heart. Doing good goes a long way to overcoming the garbage that others will put in your life. It's often discovered that when we do something good for someone, even if they don't deserve it, even we reap the benefits for that. You see, doing things God's way is always the best way. Now, please understand, I'm not trying to say that any of this is easy. Trying to do what is right, even when others have done us wrong, is hard. Trying to live at peace with others who want to live at war with us is hard. Trusting in God to avenge and repay and bring justice in His timing is hard. Overcoming our enemies with good is hard. All of this goes beyond human abilities. And they can only be achieved through the power of the Spirit that God has put within us as we submit ourselves to Him. How wonderful to know when we have put our trust in God, He will take up our cause. How wonderful to know that we have acted in accordance to His will. This leads to true peace and ultimate satisfaction and helps us to avoid that big mistake of revenge. An action that never satisfies. An action that digs bigger and deeper holes that causes more response. So the next time you are wronged and that strong desire to take vengeance into your own hands hits, just remember Wile E. Coyote and Haman the Agite. We don't want to make the same mistakes that they made. In a moment, we're going to be singing the song All to Jesus I Surrender as our commitment song. I was thinking about this last week, of all the songs that I've picked over the years to sing at the end of a sermon, this song is right up in the top five. I can't tell you exactly where it falls, but it's right up there. Why? Because the message, the reminder this song brings is one that we always need to have. It is when we surrender all to Jesus that the power to overcome, the power to make the right choices and decisions, the power to choose not to take revenge upon that person becomes available to us. All to Jesus I surrender, all to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him, in His presence daily live. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. Let's sing All to Jesus I Surrender.
I surrender. Jesus, I surrender.
We have a choice in our lives. We know that bad things are going to happen. We know that people are going to do things that are going to hurt us. That people are not going to live up to the standards we think they ought to live up to. People are going to fail us. Some of them badly. And we're going to want to take revenge. We're going to have that feelings to get back. But it is our choice to whether we do or not. When we put our trust in God, he will take up our cause. He says he will step in and do what revenge that needs to be done. We'll be able to fix the problems that need to be fixed in his time and in his way. We just need to surrender all to him. And I know that's hard. I know that's hard because I struggle with it. There are situations that I've gone through that has been so hard for me to just let God deal with it. I would like to say that every time I was able to let God deal with it, but there have been times in my life where I have failed. But God, still our God. He has still helped me through. He has forgiven me of the ultimate consequences, and I have, yes, dealt with and had to live with some of the consequences of choices I've made. I've also seen God step up and deal with situations where I wanted to get even so badly, but I chose, by the grace of God and the strength of the Spirit, to not do so. And I've seen God work wonders, healed relationships, and also provided what was needed to bring his wrath into those who did need it. Our God is a good God. Let's pray. Father God, you are our God, our Lord. We live in a wicked, wicked world. We live in a time that is so hard. I know every generation says this is the hardest it's ever been, and to us it is. And Father, we need your strength, we need your patience, we need your Spirit so that we can make the right choices and allow you to do the repaying. Help us, Father, to instead do good, to pay back evil with good, to be your hands of love and peace to those around us. Help us, Father, when we fail, to hold back onto you as you lift us back up on our feet, as we continue to strive to serve you with all that we are. Because, Father, as we look out in this world ahead of us, this week ahead of us, we need your help each day. Father, we thank you for that help. Father, this we pray in your Son's holy and precious name. Amen.